Okay, so I finally had my CPN appointment. That's a community psychiatric nurse. I'll say CPN for short. I think it went okay. You know, I think I did well with sort of how I asserted myself and said what I wanted, so that's good. In terms of the kind of questions she asked, they were, I mean, it's a bit more general than my assessments. So I don't think as many questions were asked, but the questions that she did ask were quite similar to at the assessment. So in a way I felt kind of prepared for it, and I knew most of the time what I wanted to say. So that was something. She was really nice, you know, she's very welcoming and just sort of let me speak, and I didn't feel, I mean, she shouldn't anyway, but I didn't feel like she was judging me or anything like that. And even when I was talking about quite personal things, and I said I found it really hard to, because obviously I've not met her before, but she said, honestly, it's fine. So the first question she asked was how I've been since my assessment. And I'm never sure how to answer that, because obviously one of my main problems is the mood swings that I have, and they can happen, like, within an hour. I can have more than one mood, you know, moods changing within an hour even. Some days are worse than others, of course, and there's days where I just feel numb, so I don't think I feel any emotion, or I can't connect to that emotion. So going over how I'd been since the assessment, I just said, well, I've been a bit all over the place, really. Been irritable quite a lot, really. I think there's just been a lot on my mind, my ESA claim. I was worried about some friends. It's okay now, it's sorted now, but I think it was just a lot of uncertainty and stuff, and some things are more certain now, so that's good, but it's other things as well. I don't have said this before, but in terms of, like, activism, I suppose I'm like a disability activist, and like mental health activist, because I look into what the news is around, benefits, rights for disabled people, that kind of thing. And I now especially I tend to blog about what I find out, whether it's from articles or from others, and I sort of do my best to help people out if they need help with forms and stuff and that kind of thing. It's a lot of, like, trying to do things for other people, so I don't know if I'm doing much for myself in terms of, like, self-care and stuff. I've been trying, but I don't really see myself as important as others, and it's just how I am. Just about my past, like, had anything significant happened in my past, whether it's like childhood or like early adulthood. So I talked about school, how for about 10 years I've been bullied, so I think that has a big impact on, like, how I perceive other people, the kind of trust issues that I have. I suppose how I see myself as well. I'll get into that a little bit. So I find that I can never be completely sure about what kind of person I am. I always seem to rely on other people's impressions of me. So, of course, negative impressions really cut deep with me, because I feel them so, so personally. And I think, well, they've said that, so they must be right. So it does make it very hard to say, well, actually, no, you're wrong. you know, like standing up for myself, because I tend to just believe what people say about me. And also things to do with knowing what someone thinks of you in terms of friendship. So, say I've had it in the past where I've thought someone was a close friend, and so I've treated them like a close friend, and they've not really acted that way to me, or they've stopped acting that way towards me, and it turns out that they only really saw me as an acquaintance. And yeah, I mean, that does hurt, because you sort of think, well, I've opened up to you, I felt like you were someone I could rely on, I suppose, someone who'd be there for me, and it turns out that actually I'm not really important to you in the slightest. So it makes it hard to trust people and to know whether someone is being nice to you because they like you, is being friendly to you because they see you as like a close, important friend to them, or whether it's all just them being polite. And on the other hand, I could have it where I think that somebody doesn't really like me because of some things, or the way that they've said some things, or if they've not talked to me much, and it turns out that they actually see me as quite a close friend, and it's just there being, it's been something going on in their life that's, and they're acting the same way to everybody, really. So, and I hate how I sort of turn it in on myself, because it's like I'm saying it's all about me, and it's really not. But it's very hard to get out of that frame of mind. So it's like, you know in yourself that that's not, you know, it's not always going to be the case that it's your fault that something, someone has treated you a certain way. But it's hard to feel like that, just in case they really do, they really are acting that way towards you because it's your fault. So, I explained what I could of that to the nurse. And she didn't really say anything in response. It was more sort of listening and sort of nodding, saying she understood. As for something else that happened in the past, I've written it down and the blog, because it's kind of easier to write it down there, but I still find it quite hard to say sort of out loud. It's nothing that happened in the past that has a big impact on certain problems I have today. The fact that when I was in uni in my first year, I became pregnant and I had a termination. Maybe I'll speak more about that when I can come to terms with it a bit more. That's something I think I'm going to need some sort of counselling to deal with, because I find like conversations around it, I can't really get involved in that, because even just thinking about the topic makes me really panicky and stuff. It's it actually triggers me. Another thing I mentioned a few vlogs ago that I actually didn't mention to the nurse, which I probably should have done, was a particular relationship I had a while back, and it turned out to be quite mainly psychologically abusive kind of relationship, and it's something I didn't realise until years later, finding out about like different types of abuse in relationships, and it made me feel so, horrible and panicky and tearful to think that that had happened and I hadn't really realised, and I didn't deserve to be treated the way I was. That's quite a significant thing. I feel I really should have told her about that, but I suppose I was quite nervous at the time and I couldn't think very clearly, so it just slipped my mind. I talked about with the kind of mood swings. I talked about how one thing is I get like, I can be quite impulsive, but I was, that was more sort of prominent when I was in university and when I was physically healthy. So I felt like nothing could stop me, really. And yeah, I won't go into detail about the kind of impulsive things I did, it's just I was impulsive. So and like things like pain and anxiety are what hold me back from acting on the kind of sort of urges that I have, impulsive urges that I have. And so I think that's still a factor, but it's not something someone would know about me, really. And she was asking why I think I did these impulsive things, and she wondered whether with some stuff was it kind of a case of fitting in, like everybody did it or something. But what I said was it was more of a coping mechanism, because nothing else seemed to work, really, dealing with the kind of thoughts that I had in my head and sort of trying to shut them up, trying to distract myself from them. So I suppose that's what I did, and I was focusing on something else for a bit. Yeah, she also asked me about the kind of relationships I've had with friends and family, like, is there anything going on there? Have the relationships been stable? Any big problems? And I said, family, I live with my parents and I get on really well with them, you know. I mean, obviously have our odd arguments like every family does, but I'd say that sort of my growing up with my parents has been quite stable, quite normal. So I don't see any problems there. With friends, of course, some friends that turned out to be bullies, obviously that wasn't stable, so it did give me some trust issues. But the, and also friends that when I got ill, whether physically or mentally, they sort of drifted away. You know, people I thought, again, I thought I was close to, and they just sort of left. So that was hard. To be honest, I find, like, losing a friend, I've always found that harder to deal with than losing, say, a partner, like romantic partner. I don't know why. I suppose I just expect that the friends will want to stay friends with me, like, for the rest of my life. But there you go, that's how it is. And I really hurts when I lose friends, because I know I get very attached, and like when I like someone, I like them very much, and they mean a hell of a lot to me, and I find it hard to just let go. There can be times where if something's happened, they've done or said something that really, I really can't deal with. I can't think of an example at the moment, but just something that really shocks me or whatever. Sometimes I have, like, cut contact straight away. I've just, like, blocked them or something. But generally, most of the time I really attach myself to people, and like letting go is hard. I dwell on it. There's still people that have cut contact with me and I still find I dwell on it now, and I really miss them, but what can I do? I don't talk about the physical health problems that I have and when they started, and of course the hypermobility syndrome. Obviously, hypermobility I've had my whole life, but and it was sort of later on in life that it became a syndrome, so you had the pains and stuff and the dislocations and that with it. And the fibromyalgia, I started having symptoms of that in 2010, so So I was about halfway through uni. And I mean, I'd had mental health problems for as long as I can remember. So I think I at least had some anxiety problems, like maybe anxiety disorder, right from childhood. And of course, I'd link that to the bullying. But the depression tended to come, suppose, towards the end of uni. I didn't really realise. It took me a long time to get up the courage to get help for that. And she asked me like what sort of therapy I'd had, and I talked about my last lot of therapy, how it had stopped suddenly, and how it came to me being referred to secondary mental health services. So I talked about how for over a year I've been thinking that I might have borderline personality disorder, and I'd been looking at the diagnostic criteria, I've been talking to friends with it, and just sort of making sure that I'm not just quickly looking at the symptoms and sort of making it fit me. It's that I really can relate to a lot of the symptoms, and I can relate to a lot of people with BPD. So it feels that the diagnosis really fits me, but because of stigma attached to it, and lack of knowledge about it really, it took me a while to get up the courage to approach someone and say, I think I have this, could you like assess me for it, or refer me for assessment. So I felt at the time that I could trust my therapist, so I thought it would go okay, but it really didn't. So I brought up the topic with him, and then he sort of fobbed me off, and he said BPD is something that psychiatrists diagnose you with when they don't know what's wrong with you. So I quoted this to the CPN at my appointment, and she sort of raised her eyebrows. And she, you know, I was saying to her, well, as you know, it's not like, what do they call it, a wastebasket diagnosis. It's not like, you know, it's something, it's specific diagnostic criteria. It's a real, well, personality disorder. It's a real thing. And, you know, it's got the specific diagnostic criteria. So you have to meet so much of that criteria in order to get that diagnosis. It's not like you don't fit any other box, so we'll plonk you in this one. It's different. So I don't know where he got that idea from, but he's completely wrong about it. But yeah, the nurse agreed with me. She was like, well, yeah, as we know, it's a real diagnosis. So yeah, yeah, because of course, because of that, she asked what makes me think I have BPD. And I'm just going off the top of my head, the kind of symptoms that it said in the diagnostic criteria. So there's the sort of unstable mood, so changing so much, and of course having the days where you feel numb, so it's almost like an all or nothing kind of thing, which is really exhausting. So I was saying about that, and of course I'd explained about how my moods have been changing a lot recently. Also the things with relationships, with friends, partners, family, that kind of thing, how my relationships, I've not had any sort of long term ones, maybe they just can't handle me. And as for friends, like people I thought were friends letting me down and stuff like that, and the bullying and stuff, making it very hard to trust people. But there's also the getting attached really quickly. It's strange how different I can act with that. So like I lose trust easily, I suppose, but and get attached to people easier, so maybe I trust people I shouldn't or whatever. I do, of course, the true friends that I have, they're the sort of stability in my life. I know another sort of key thing with BPD is the self-harming, and I do that nearly every day, and that's also my coping mechanism. And she asked me also other kind of problems that I have. So I talked about, of course, I was diagnosed with depression and anxiety, and in my notes it says either I'm showing symptoms of OCD or I actually have the diagnosis of it, but I'm not sure because I haven't been able to see my notes, and that's something I keep meaning to sort of write a letter to the practice manager of my GP's office and surgery to sort of pay to gain access to those records, get a copy of them, so I can find out exactly what I'm diagnosed with or what they've considered, because I feel like I've been left in the dark with that. But yeah, one of the things, OCD, so she asked me about the kind of routines that I have. So I told her about one that I have, that I've had for a few years, and also about one I had when I was in school, and it was another, I suppose, sort of a coping mechanism to deal with the bullying that I went through. And it started, I was probably about 13, 14, and me and some friends had been reading up about things like paganism, and I mean, it was only really on a very superficial level that we'd been reading about this stuff. So we've probably got very inaccurate ideas of it, and the same thing that stuck in my mind really was to do with blessings and prayers. And I thought, well, if I do certain blessings at certain times, a certain amount of times, then I would sort of be protected in a way, and the bullying wouldn't be as bad the next day. So it got to a point where I had to do these blessings in a certain order at exactly midnight, and I had to do them 3 times each. And I also I had like lucky charms that I kept with me throughout the school day, and certain things I had to keep in certain pockets of my blazer. And the nurse asked me, well, what would happen if one of the lucky charms wasn't there, like you forgot it or something? And I said, well, I think that's actually happened before, where I've forgotten one or lost one, and I'd been very anxious throughout the day. I wouldn't be able to keep it out of my mind. I'd be constantly expecting to be picked on really badly again, and even though I knew it wasn't there, I'd still be checking that particular pocket for it. So of course, it was very rarely that I'd be without all of those lucky charms, so because it seemed like such an important thing for me to have those on me. So yeah, she asked me what kind of medication I'm on, if I'm on any, and I've probably said this before, but I take sertraline for my depression and anxiety, and I think for OCD as well, and I have that at the highest dose, so I mean, it only helps a little bit, so I don't know if it's really working. I thought it would work better being at the highest dose, but we'll have to see. I also take, very rarely I take diazepam, and that's for like my really, really worst days, so it's basically when I'm in crisis, and that's the only thing that sort of calms me down and makes me feel a bit safer. I only have a short prescription of that, and last time I got it refilled, the doctor I saw said she'd rather than refill it after I'd finished that amount, she'd rather I went for the therapy to see if that would help me. So I don't know if I'm going to get diazepam again. I mean, if I can find a way to cope without it, that would be fine. But I need some sort of safety net, I suppose you can call it. Okay, so I mentioned that to her, and that was pretty much covers the kind of things that she asked me. So she written lots of notes, and she went over what I told her, and she gave me her sort of impression of it. And at first she said that she thinks that primary care would be more suitable for my illnesses and the severity, complexity, that kind of thing. And when she said that, I think it was quite obvious that I was disappointed, because primary care seemed to be a bit too simplistic for me, from my experience anyway. So my heart sank a little about that, and I was sort of saying to her, but I'm not sure, you know, I was hoping that I'd get more support, ongoing support particularly, and that I wanted to have a CPN so I had that point of contact. And because I'd been feeling quite lost with navigating mental health services, it seemed to be therapy or nothing, and if that wasn't going well, I didn't really have someone knowledgeable I could talk to about it. And I didn't know about what other kinds of help I could get, and CPN would help with that. So she said, she had a bit of a think, and she said, well, unfortunately, because of changes to mental health services, so I took that to mean cuts. The secondary care team, my local one, they don't do like ongoing long-term support. It tends to be short pieces of work to do with particular problems. So say you have an anxiety disorder, could be acrophobia, could be something else, and maybe because of that you have real trouble leaving the house and travelling. So they help you do a short piece of work with you to help you to gain the skills to be able to do a bit more towards travelling on your own and stuff. I don't, you know, as much as they can manage at the time, we all improve at different rates. So she said maybe we could do that, and she mentioned getting a support worker involved, so that sounds quite good. I mean, I think I need something more sort of practical. I know it's going to be scary, it's going to be difficult, but I'm so fed up of feeling so restricted with what I can do. So it would be great if I could travel a bit more, because it means that I could actually go and see friends, and that would be wonderful. And also mentioned about the things with not knowing what diagnoses I have and wanting an assessment for BPD, because I still haven't had one. And she said that she's going to book me an appointment with a consultant, like psychiatrists, for an assessment for that. So hopefully that'll give me a bit of clarity, and if it's not BPD, that's fine. I just want to know why I'm feeling the way I am, because there's things that I feel that don't really fit the depression, anxiety diagnoses. So as long as that's cleared up, you know, I'm fine, and as long as I'm getting the support I need, or as much as they can offer me anyway, because I know because of cuts, they can't offer me absolutely everything that might be suitable. I'm just asking for enough support to keep me going, I suppose. But yeah, I suppose with that consultant appointment, they'll probably go over the kind of medication that I'm on, see whether I need anything else, or whether I need anything adding to my medication. Kind of hope not. I mean, I don't want to take any more medication than I already am, but if there's something I could tolerate that might suit me better than sertraline, that might help my symptoms a bit more, that'd be great. But anyway, I don't know, we'll have to see. So overall, I think I'm happy with how the appointment went. I said most of what I want to say. There's things that I wish I'd mentioned, like about the that abusive relationship and that, but she did say to contact her if there's anything that I thought of that I forgot to mention during the appointment, and I don't know, maybe I should ring up and mention about that. I don't know if it'll make any difference to the kind of support that I'll get, but I don't know, it's something to add to my notes, I suppose. And so I've got an appointment with her on the 29th of this month. Sorry, just checking the calendar. So yeah, I'll probably do a vlog possibly the day after that appointment, so to let you know how that one went, and hopefully things will be a bit clearer then.